What I'm going to talk about is basically how to look at evidence within your program. How do you do what is called as an evidence-informed program design or evidence-informed practice? My assumption is that most of you are from the social work background, either during your internship or during your work, or maybe at the research, you're interacting with many organizations which are implementing projects, or you're part of any community component. So what I'm going to talk is how to conduct a systematic review, but how do you use evidence for informing program design or practice or any of that kind of aspect. So basically I'll try to describe what is evidence-informed practice, what constitutes evidence, and how do you use of evidence in designing and evaluating social programs. And so I come from a public health background, and currently there is some work that we are doing on evidence-informed, and I'll give an example of one of the health. And that's why it was mentioned that I'll be using a public health example, because I don't have much exposure to a social program kind of a logic where we have used evidence. What is evidence-informed practice, or what is evidence-informed program design, is where you start looking, does my intervention has existing evidence of it worked or working, or it will work in what context? This is typically missed out in the most of the program design components. We just say that some literature we find out, we found X organizations doing it, or maybe UN has suggested this intervention, or WHO has suggested this intervention, or this is part of the law, so we suggest that this is the intervention that we would like to look. And then we go into an area which is called as, we will do an experiment. Hum intervention karenge, aur fir dekhenge ki kya hota hai. But that is not what is called as evidence-informed practice, which is why this has become important. Is one is because a priori you want to know what is the impact that I am going to achieve if I put this intervention. But since we are working in a resource-constrained environment, we would also like to know that are we going to achieve what we set out to achieve, and at what cost? Is it cost-effective compared to any other alternative? Maybe the peer-to-peer counseling could be done in many ways. You can do either training of one set of, you can use teachers to create that group, or you can select a particular group of children, train them and get them to do another peers, which is more cost effective. Is it using the teachers to create those peer-to-peer, peers on child side? We know that peer-to-peer counseling or peer-to-peer groups is more effective in managing child abuse in community or group settings than actually just training a child about what constitutes abuse. If you have worked in that area, sirf bacche ko abuse kya hai nahi sikhayenge, uske alawa uske peer ko bhi ki agar kisi ka shoshan ho raha hai to what is that shoshan and how do you pick up that, can only happen when you have peers working together as a group and working all together, right? Now the objective of using evidence is to understand, is there a cause and effect? And is there an evidence of the cause to effect? Right? And that is the cycle that we have to look at. So here the constitution is not to develop evidence, but to value the use of evidence and how to interpret existing evidence for designing a program. What I mentioned in my talk in the morning is how do you generate system, basically conducting systematic review as a researcher and seeing that there's a methodology in which you do that. But most of us who are in the social work programs or even in the evaluation phase cannot wait for a systematic review to be done and then wait for evidence, because right now there's already some evidence. But how do you identify that evidence? One. And how do you interpret that evidence is free of bias and error and there is no bias? We have seen that even in a systematic review based on the researcher, we know bias can exist. Confirmatory bias, somebody mentioned. There's something called as outcome bias. Do you know what's an outcome bias? Outcome bias in evaluation and research is basically where you say that you will only report positive findings but do not report negative findings, where you only report significant results but would not emphasize on insignificant results. This happens in all of our studies. We struggle in India, call it the struggle for p-value. We all struggle in our PhD thesis to get that significant p-value, but insignificant p-value is also a finding. Negative is also a finding. Something that does not work. Can you imagine how much value is it in medicine? Do you want to know every time something works, you also want to know something did not work? So why not in social programs? Why is it not important to know why it is not working or it is not working? That's equally important to know as much as that it worked. And everywhere I see this, and I have done the same mistake 10 years back. Now I'm a born again Christian, like they call it. Now we are born again. But now I look at that every negative result, every negative outcome is also a learning by itself, because I don't repeat it, and if I document it, others might also benefit with it. So outcome bias is basically where you don't report it. But how do you interpret in a study that there is outcome bias? How do you interpret in a study just by reading a paper? You don't know the authors, you don't know the program, all is sitting with a paper and looking at evidence. So the objective is, one is to identify the evidence so that you can do an informed, evidence-informed practice, but also to interpret whether that evidence is free of its own bias. That's something that you cannot do. You're not going to redo that study in a particular manner to overcome it. You have to interpret that study from some methodology to see whether that research is free of its own bias. Outcome bias, or we call it confirmatory bias. Confirmatory bias is basically where the group or the author confirms, already has a pre-existing notion, and say this is how the result, and then they try to confirm the results around that notion, or they confirm themselves around that findings. We see a lot of them in clinical or public health research, because they come from a certain clinical background or a clinical area, and they try to bound the results in that method, right? So these are some aspects that why it has become important. Second is, also while doing it, it is also important that how do we interpret the effectiveness of various interventions. So when I struggle, what I struggle is, oh, what do you do? I worked on child abuse. I said, fine, but then how do you do it? How do you conduct, how do you manage the child abuse? Because every organization has a thematic area, but they don't explain very clearly what is the intervention that actually you're focusing on. Right? And does that intervention has enough evidence to justify that you as an organization can keep proposing it to happen? And then what we do is, because one, it worked one place, we assume that it can be replicated in Tamil Nadu also. Because it was done by a grand NGO, the other NGO organization also starts to emulate, and then the same thing happens, and then they realize after 3 years when they do an end line, oh, Bombay mein to chal gaya, but Chennai mein nahi chal raha. Had they understood that under what context will my evidence implementation work, if had they thought that, rather than just adapting directly and saying, oh, it worked in Bombay, it will work in Chennai, even though both are metro cities, but we know, I'm born and brought up in Mumbai, but in Mumbai children are much more open in terms of their way that they communicate. I'm not saying Chennai children are not, but that's the way that the city is built in. You know, we have Bollywood and other things, and we are exposed to a lot of other factors much earlier in childhood. So have we looked at context when we are kind of transferring the implementation results to a different context, and have we made design changes at that level? And that is what is the whole my talk all about, that why is evidence important when you make a practice decision. And when I say practice, means you're not making a policy decision, you're designing a practice, you're designing an intervention. And from where do you pick this evidence? What constitutes evidence? How do you do it? So basically, if you look from a clinical side, say for example, you're managing, if you're managing, say, anti-tobacco or maybe antenatal care, right? So most of you will be familiar that when a pregnant woman gets pregnant, she has to have at least minimum 3 visits in her antenatal period. And during that 3 antenatal visits, she has to do X number of components, tests and etc., take some medicines, and then she's considered as safe, that she's managed antenatal. The question is not about provision always. When I was working many years back in Nanded, there were women who would come for antenatal visit, but after 10 days they will stop their folic acid because nobody has sat down and explained to her why you have to consume 100 tablets of folic acid. So they made a visit, they had 10, and then they start seeing that the urine is becoming red. Then somebody, they will ask a neighbor and they say, oh, tumhara to bleed ho raha hai, maybe it's because of the tablet, and then they stop it. So the whole aspect is based on, we missed out on the patient preferences. We missed out on patient action. We did not think that just by providing antenatal care and understanding that there is a concept that you need to think, whether peer pressure and all that, and if you don't work from that side also, is something that is also important. And what are the clinical state and circumstances in which that woman is functioning? Because every woman will have its own social fabric in which she functions as a woman, and being a mother stretches that fabric even more. How do you put all these components and make an evidence-informed decision is what we are talking here. We never think about it. We don't plan our projects in that manner. We just assume that antenatal care provision is the best way, and then we design and then we put it on the ground, and then we wait for a midterm or an end-line evaluation to tell us what worked and what did not work. Right? If you are looking at, so for example, some of you, I'm sure that your parent or someone would be in the in the share market business, right? You look at a 10-year history of that company, look at balance sheets, and then you take what is called as an informed decision or an informed risk. If your parents are having some kind of surgery, some medical issue, you're explained the entire problem, you're explained all the effects, all the risk, all the benefits of the surgery, and only then you take a decision. So you sit on that evidence and then you make a decision. And we design multi-million dollar projects without understanding whether there is evidence for this to work, yes or no. And if it works, then what context will it work? Will it work in my context? So sometimes I also talk to practitioners who are actually needed to interpret evidence. They are not like some of you who would go ahead and conduct a systematic review. It's also important to understand this particular component. So basically, what is evidence-informed practice? Basically, it's an approach on making decisions on best practices involving a systematic approach to literature and other sources of evidence. You'll keep hearing the word called systematic, systematic, systematic in my talk, and I'll just take 1 minute after this couple of slides to explain what it is, right? But here, evidence-informed practice is an approach to make decisions on best practices involving a systematic approach to literature and other sources of evidence. It basically means using evidence to identify the potential benefits, harms, and cost of any intervention, and also acknowledging what works in one context may not be appropriate or feasible in another. And what is evidence-informed practice? It brings together not just published evidence from some other context, it also brings local evidence with the best available evidence from research. So you do baseline and then look at that baseline, look at already available evidence and check, and then go and design. And something that I noticed, I'm a clinician for background. I come from a physiotherapy, physical therapy background. But my first of my careers 10, 12 years back was a program manager. I used to design programs. And something that, and when I used to be, you know, after a year, and I've developed managed programs across 2 countries, 14 states, having beneficiaries like million people covered in an annual year, budgets of $2 million kind of a thing. What we always miss out to do, what is called as a pre-implementation phase. We never spend time on actually designing a month or a two to actually spend time that how do I design the program. It's not just about picking one intervention and putting out the ground. It's about actually conducting the baseline, using evidence from already existing literature. Is there evidence for something that is working? What should I do differently in my context to design that? And many projects actually fail because they don't spend this 1 or 2 months on doing what is called as a pre-implementation design. Because once you implement it, you only have time after a year to actually redesign it. And by that time, half the year, half of your project, because most projects are between 3 years to 5 years, or sometimes less than that. So you might not be able to do a mid-course correction. Right? A 18-month project or a 24-month project will not give you any chance to do a mid-course correction. Whereas maybe 36 months, a 48-month or a 60-month project might give you some scope. So at that pre-implementation phase, I only heard the word called baseline. But nobody is telling me, okay, it must have worked somewhere. Collect that evidence. And your baseline should then complement that finding. And then you go and look, go back to your drawing board and say, how do I design this intervention in my context? And find out and then implement it and then make what is called as a program design. This is what is the entire genesis or the value of evidence-informed practice. In that time, you're not interpreting or you're not going to conduct a systematic review to know what evidence is out there. You have to collect that already existing evidence in some manner. So first, when should be evidence be considered is when we are in the planning stages of an intervention or a program. And second, when you're evaluating the program, either in a midterm or a like an end term, then the findings actually get disseminated and you should build an evidence base. We don't value the end evaluation or any of those documents into a technical report and then we put it into a public domain because we forget that 2 years down the line, this particular document might be useful for some other organization who could use this findings to improve that evidence when they are designing that program 4 years down the line. So the value of generating evidence and creating I call it that most of the publications that we do are of social good of nature. It's not just for research purpose. You're actually doing a social good by publishing good articles or good evaluation or any of those reports and putting it in public domain, not lying in a bound thesis in one of the libraries here because nobody's going to read it. After your thesis is sitting in the bound library, I saw some of them in Professor Burt's room. Except Professor Burt or maybe some of your close friends, nobody is going to read that after that. So please consider it. The objective now to create those databases in that context is actually use that. In abroad, you have something called as a ProQuest. ProQuest is an academic database where your PhD thesis can be uploaded. Last couple of years only, not too much. But what I'm trying to say is that the technical reports when we do program evaluation, that's not part of your thesis, but I'm just saying even that don't go into a program. It doesn't go into NGO organization, doesn't sit in a website. I met Ambuja Cement Foundation last month in Bombay. Grant making organization having an excellent monitoring and evaluation unit, so much so that they actually used a randomized control trial for managing coastal natural resource management in Gujarat. What did they do with the report? Nothing. It's not available on the website. It's not available for anybody else except themselves. I said, why are you? You are doing actually a wrong thing by building so much evidence. Somebody else wants to work on natural resource management. Where will you get that? If you want to generate, synthesize evidence, for the first thing is you need evidence. And the evidence is anything that is done. It is not just about a technical report, any published document, and that's what we focus on. We don't assume evidence to be published literature alone. That's a mistake that all of us done. 3 years of a PhD thesis would be much stronger than a poorly done evaluation report, which is only maybe done for 2-3 months. So a publication status has no relation to the quality of a paper or a technique or a report. It's got no value. And that's what the world of evidence synthesis tells you, that unless it is appraised using a checklist, we call it critical appraisal, and that's actually relevant for all study design. You cannot call that study a good study. And you don't use it differently on a published study or an unpublished study because you're already constituting a bias. We call it publication bias. The assumption is because it's published, it will be a good study, which is not the case. So whenever I look at people generating evidence, they go to Google Scholar and they pick out journals and they look at that And they forget that in the social sciences, in at least in India, or at least for social sciences, less than 27% of the actual work gets published in India. So you have entirely 73% sitting with no publication. That means it's not entering any kind of journal or any kind of peer review process at all. So if you're restricting yourself to search for evidence only on a peer review domain, you're losing out on the 73%, which is not sitting on any peer review database, PubMed or Journal of Social Work or any of those kinds. Let me go back to the Ambuja Cement Foundation example. So we asked, me and my CEO were both there, and we asked this critical question that, why didn't you publish this work? Because this is your own evidence. And it was not a program. They used it as part of their own understanding to know whether something has worked, and it was part of a pilot. One thing that they said is, a technical report is more easier to do because it doesn't go into a structure of a scientific article. Those who have written a publication will know that there's a certain language, there's a certain structure, you cannot put more than X tables and two figures and all that, so there's a limitation. So we said, fine, why didn't you publish as a technical report? Then they say, even if I put it in a technical report, how many people will enter Ambuja Cement Foundation and check for publication? So it's a thing that questions the people, then. But we ask them, if you don't put it, no one will anyway find it anyway. So at least put it out there. Let at least the system reach where, so in the UK and in the abroad, many UK at least, what now they are doing is they are creating what is called as public databases or evaluations, where any evaluation done by anyone can be sitting on one repository. It's now very predominant in Norway. I was trained in New Zealand. New Zealand, every project, 15% of the budget by compulsory has to be on evaluation. And it is compulsory if it's funded by the government, which is predominantly the case, that the evaluation reports have to be placed in a public domain. So it's a matter of having systems which kind of create that demand, that through regulation is what worked in New Zealand. But in Norway, it works because people actually genuinely feel that my work will benefit someone else's work. So there is a social reason in Norway. So I don't know what is going to work in India, whether it is going to be regulation. As much as I know, it looks more from an organizational side, that the organization will have to decide that they use evidence, so they have to place their evidence so that others can use it. I think that's the only way that can take it forward. So this is where the evidence is concerned. One is when we are planning for an intervention, right? And when I say intervention, you're not just putting one intervention. You're not putting just peer-to-peer counseling. You're also going to look at how do I implement the mechanism in going to implement the peer-level counseling, right? So if you're saying peer-level counseling to managing child abuse, that's your intervention. But how are you going to implement that intervention is another evidence altogether. So one is to look at whether there is evidence that peer-to-peer education or peer-to-peer counseling is more effective compared to any other interventions to manage child abuse in schools. That's one level of evidence. The second level of evidence is, how do I implement that peer-to-peer counseling? Should I use training of teachers approach? Should I use senior students, or some children may be more active than others? Should I use senior peers to train the junior peers and create that as a counseling? Then the level of evidence is actually on the implementation. It's not on the selection of the intervention. Are you able? Because there's a base and then you implement it. But the implementation forms can also be different. I can do the same lecture sitting in my office and using a Skype or a mechanism. Is that more effective compared to this one? In both the things, I'm giving a talk. But which is more effective? This is more effective because I can come, and face to face is more interactive. There's more opportunity to discuss than a Skype, and there's no personal atmosphere in which we can work. So one is what is called as giving a talk on evidence-informed practice, but the second is way that you do that talk, right? So this is something that is important, not just so you identify an issue, you identify an intervention, but then how to implement it. Now, that is something that you can, that is where actually your evidence from various studies on evaluation of process implementation will help you. And many people forget that as the evaluation. Many people focus only on the impact, but don't document the process in which that impact was achieved. So we don't do what is called as completely, most of the evaluations are focused on impact evaluation. Now the world realizes that I also want to know how something was done so that it could achieve this impact. And that can only come through what is called as process evaluation. So imagine where you want to know, okay, this is how many organizations, one organization has done this process. Imagine how if you can just synthesize and bring it together, you have much more evidence base to say, okay, this is how it, I think it can be working in my situation. So when you look at evidence, see, what I'm trying to tell you is, in this evidence-informed practice, every level has to be thought and understood, and then you should have an evidence base. And I'll say what constitutes evidence after this. So first, the value is, first is understanding evidence-informed practice. Second is valuing that evidence, but evidence can sit at various levels. It's not just identifying the intervention, but also below. Now, within that, as a program manager, shouldn't you be considering more cost per rupee? Then you have to consider, is it more cost effective? Is this methodology going to be less costly compared to this? But if I, is it less costly but less effective also? That also becomes important, because then as a manager, you're managing resources. And we do all these thought only at the end evaluation phase. We never do this in the planning stage. And then we kind of figure out, अरे क्या हम कर सकते ऐसा भी कर सकते थे वैसा भी कर सकते आपने तो पहले सोचा ही नहीं. And we don't do this program designing in this manner. Unfortunate part. We talk so much about log frame and we talk so much about program implementation document, but we forget, is there evidence to anything that we are talking in that meeting? You are just saying because you believe so. What if your belief is wrong? What if your belief worked in that setting and might not work in this setting? How will you make that judgment? So that's what I am trying to say, is value evidence as the basis. Don't base it on experience. Because a program is not like kids. You know, our parents use their experience to teach our kids. That's fine, because they cannot take experience. But what they do is they also take a lot of experience. They take their experience from their own parents. They take their experience from their friends managing kids. But we can't do for projects. In projects, we can't take that risk. Right? So what constitutes evidence? Now, we've been talking about evidence-informed practice. We talked about that there is value of evidence. We're now going to talk about what constitutes evidence. So basically, a theory of change, or what is called as program theory. So program theory essentially means that there is a theory on which the program assumes that there could be an outcome or an impact, right? Now, that theory has to be tested by many people. Otherwise, how can you say that it works? So many years back, those who have worked on qualitative, if you know what is called as inductive reasoning, deductive reasoning, will always realize that you sit on a theory. Theory-based research means you sit on a theory, and that theory is tested by you, then another researcher, and another researcher, another researcher, and then finally it becomes what is called as a model. And then you say, using that model or that theory, we evaluated it, and we found that these findings were reliable or comparable to the theory, existing theories. Correct? So before it becomes a theory, these are just statements. So till Newton said that gravity is the cause for some object to be thrown up to down, it was just a statement. But he actually had to create a mathematical equation to prove that gravity exists. Because till then it was just a statement. Then it became the theory, and now there are enough principles and methods to prove that gravity exists. We don't have to bother about it. Right? That is the logic of a theory of change. Basically, theory of change means we assume that there is a theory in which some things work and there is a change happening because of this underlying theory. Right? But it works in a certain environment. And because there are certain stakeholders and there are certain activities that are conducted, and hence it has what is called as immediate outcomes, intermediate outcomes, and long-term outcomes. And finally, you have a program impact. So the whole packaging of this socio-economic political context or environment, then basing it on below, which is called as barriers and enablers, under which the entire program functions, then you have certain groups under which you work, then you do certain activities, and then you have certain assumptions that these are the outcomes that you'll achieve, these are the intermediate outcomes, and these are the final outcomes, and hence the final outcomes are also called as impact. This entire relation is coming from a theory of change. But why you say that this arrow, by doing this activity, you reach this outcome, is because of existing evidence, not because you feel so. And that existing evidence comes from a whole sort of sources. So it could be where your program has a new link to a respected theory. But also we can also look at various components to say this is how the component of the program we are taking. So if you are doing teacher-based training, so there is anybody read the book called Checklist Manifesto by Atul Gawande? It's come as a big word these days called as checklist. So if you ever travel in an aircraft, and if you ever have time or maybe permission to stand in the cockpit before the pilot is actually starting, you'll notice that he opens a book. In fact, McDonald's also does it. He opens a book and checks, and then he sees whether everything is there, right? And aircraft engineers actually use something called as a checklist. Checklist to show that, okay, I've checked the gas, I've checked this, and I've checked that, and I checked this, and I checked that. Now, this guy called Dr. Atul Gawande is a physician based out of the US. He's an Indian, but is now in the US for many years. And he has now structured the same checklist for surgically operation theaters also. Right? The reason is because many of the errors in surgery, you must have heard many tales, right leg was fractured, left leg was operated, opened, and then you had one kisi ka scissor pet mein reh gaya and all that. So a lot of medical errors happen in OT because it's a high pressure, very concentrated time of work, and there's a team approach which doesn't work like a cricket team. They're not practicing day in and day out. Aaj jo duty pe wo aa jati hai as a nurse, somebody's an anesthetist who's available, so they don't know to coordinate all the time. The only way that they can manage error-free environment is using a checklist. And he actually used that checklist in most operation theaters and found that the same safety can be managed even in operation theaters if you use that checklist. Now that checklist has now come to India in the form of what is called as Better Birth Program, where that checklist is now used to understand managing delivery complications for a whole set of settings. But that checklist cannot be used by the doctor and the A&M and the non-A&M equally. You'll have to create different checklists. But there is an evidence that this works. It worked in aircraft industry, then it was tested in operating rooms, it got worked, and then you use it in context here. It was used using a randomized control trial, and now it is constituted by WHO that this checklist is useful for developing or conducting high-risk pregnancies in most developing settings. This is how every component of the program can also be used by basing on evidence. You just don't use because something is out there, right? Or it can also look at overall effectiveness. So, aapka program is effective because there's already... So, if, for example, antenatal program in a particular country has worked because there is, this counseling. So, it's not antenatal program. Many of these non-communicable diseases actually work better not because service is available. Basically because people are counseled better that you have a disease, you have to manage it along with the doctor. Now there is enough evidence around that to show that counseling actually improves diabetes or improves cardiovascular conditions like hypertension and blood pressure much better than drugs alone. Right? So there is evidence around it, and using that is how you design the program. Now that evidence can come in the form of numerical data, which is quantitative. It also comes from descriptive, which is qualitative. But to be called as evidence, please understand that there is something called as data. Then you have information. Information becomes knowledge. And then knowledge becomes evidence. So not all data can be considered into evidence. Because these are just spots of data here and there. Right? So if you have to consider it as evidence, first it has to be, the data has to be collected properly. Then you have to synthesize, or someone had to synthesize that data from various studies in a proper manner, and only then can it inform research or practice. So it's not just cherry picking some studies here or there and then saying, oh, it worked here, this study says so. If you notice that study, the same study will always refer to another study. And if you go and look the same study, he's also going to speak the same language. But you should look at contrary evidence and see, okay, if I put both for and against, then what do I do? Does it still make valuable suggestion that it still works? Then only it constitutes that evidence. Because if you look at a paper which is anyway talking about that this thing works, they will always refer to papers where it works. It will not going to compare where things did not work. So what's the point of additionally looking at that paper? And that's the mistake that many of us do in our literature review. We use snowballing. We look at one paper, then uske references mein jaake, we look at their references. You're going to get the same opinion. How will you get a different opinion? We all do that. Invariably, I don't think before I made this statement, anybody is so conscious. Now I saw somebody shaking his head. That means I'm talking sense. Then what you do is you already confirm, mujhe toh yehi review ka question karna hai, yehi research karna hai. Let me look at all the studies that justifies it. You never look at contrary evidence. You don't look at contrary paper, not a contrary publication, and try to still argue, am I choosing my research question after looking at all the current evidence out there, and have I judged it on the basis of both conflicting and supporting statements? Your 3 years of your life is spent on one research question. It's not cheap. 3 years of your life in your 20s is not cheap. You will only repent when you come in your 30s and 40s. And like sir says, ki, are, hum PhD mein sahi karte toh aaj kahan pahunch jate. Not that he's done it, I'm just saying. But you should value your 3 years or your 2 years. It's not a joke picking up a topic and researching on the topic for 3 years without valuing, did I ask my question correctly? Did I look at all the evidence to justify that does this research question give me the proper method to go about asking the evidence? Am I adding to more new evidence around that? Or am I just confirming because this is what I believe in, I've seen it in the field, and I come here and argue, mujhe toh yehi karna hai. Because ye toh maine field mein dekha hai. That's experiential learning, that's not evidence. Right? So that's what is constituting evidence. We all do that. I'm not trying to justify myself. I'm not saying that I am free from this sin. I have also been a sinner. I also do it, but I don't do it anymore, or at least I try not to do it anymore as much as possible. And that's the job of an evidence synthesis specialist, because I don't refer to my own studies anymore. I refer to evidence that suggests whether I need to speak yes or no. Let me tell you, last year, even the great Stephen Hawking was contested because he was referring to his own 6 studies. And somebody from the group asked him, did you look at other evidence to justify your statements? Because you're referring to your own studies. So if the great Stephen Hawking can be questioned, who are we sitting in these places? And say, this is my fact. So the world of evidence is going beyond individual confirmations and biases. It tries to look at evidence. And those who call themselves as truth seekers will always be evidence seekers also. And if I have researchers, if you are that group, then you should be talking about it. Now, what would you mean that you have? So I have talked about evidence and design and everything. That I also told you what is evidence. And I also told you when to use evidence. But it is not a static approach. You can't just sit on evidence and then forget about it. So you have to first synthesize evidence from all studies. Systematic review is one of the ways to do it. Referring to a systematic review is one of the best approaches to look at existing evidence. So that you don't go and generate evidence, you use existing evidence. And one of the resources, it could be the Campbell Library, it could be the Concrete Library, but please keep a habit of referring to a systematic review, not just published studies, for constituting your argument for a particular research question. Have that habit. Once you do that, then consult the evidence base to inform your design. Then test it locally. Use a baseline, but don't use it just because you want to know what is the condition. Look at mixed methods to understand what is not working, why is it not working. Don't just plan a baseline to collect some data. It should actually help your design. So use mixed method approach, because that is a much constituted structure of understanding what is the, you know, what works and why, what will work and what did not work, or where things are, rather than a straightforward quantitative design and we do a baseline. Everywhere I go, baseline, what baseline means? Survey. No, survey is not a baseline, right? Then you pilot it. Check for, if you're having scope, pilot for 2 months, 3 months. Check, is there any scope where I can do something differently, learn from it? And the only way you do it is by doing process documentation. Document the process. Is A&M ke saath, why is one village working better than the other village? Is it because of the A&M? Is it because I did my training differently? Is because the people there are different? We never ask these questions. So unless you do process documentation of your projects, that what worked, what did not work, why it worked, why it did not work, and then you go about going to scale, which is like expanding. Either you do it in the same project if you're lucky, or you wait for 2 years, develop all these processes, collect further evidence, and then use it to scale up. And then once you scale up, don't forget that what works small need not work when it's large. Those who know, I mean, cooking will know that you can't use the same proportion to cook for 4 members and 40 members. So it's the same logic for program design as well. The way that you designed your program to manage 10,000 people, if you want to reach 1 million, you cannot design in the same manner. And if it worked there, then you have to test there as well to see whether it has worked. And then that becomes evidence. And then it becomes, so it's a cycle. It is not a static process that today what is evidence will remain evidence tomorrow. It will become newer evidence then, and that will improve the design at that particular time, at that particular area. So it's a whole cycle approach, and it has to be context relevant. Unfortunately, our government programs, Swachh Bharat Abhiyan you call it, or any of those, never look at these contexts. We look at just, humko to total lead sanitation. Anyway, Swachh Bharat Abhiyan is a more glorified version of total lead sanitation campaign. There's nothing different, except that it's gone beyond and extended to building toilets, which we now know are becoming godowns and other things, and not about using toilets anymore. So the intervention was focused properly, right? There's no harm. Swachh Bharat Abhiyan as an intervention is not bad at all. But within that, the activities that they focus, they did not realize that unless you involve communities, unless you involve groups, which is what the movie was trying to do, that unless you have people involved in the process, all this Swachh Bharat Abhiyan will just become use of toilet, I mean building toilets and nothing more. So it has to be context relevant. So beyond that evidence, you have to, so what I'm saying is, okay, you have the mechanism of Swachh Bharat Abhiyan. Water and sanitation definitely improves public health outcomes much better. Constructing toilets is also a good intervention, no doubt on it. But the evidence that to make it work, unless you involve community engagement, and there is a systematic review explaining that. So the background is that you should have involved these elders, you should have involved the community groups and involved them, which is not the case. Everywhere it's just about ticking mark that how many people are building toilets. And you're assuming that as the indicator for Swachh Bharat Abhiyan, or what is called as, now many people are saying 100% defecation free, right? Now 100% defecation free though, possibly nahi hai koi gaon mein, unless it's, even in Kerala, in my own village, which is 100% literacy, I don't think we are getting 100% defecation free anyway, or ODF free or whatever. The value is that unless there's a certain cultural factors that is there, unless you break that, you cannot go into this. So just by having an every Kerala house has a toilet. There's very rarely a Kerala house will have no toilet. But I still remember in my childhood, many of us, including myself, have done this. But we never looked at it from that side. So what I'm trying to tell is that there is evidence, and every step you have to use evidence as a part, and not just say because you believe in something, that's why you decide. So one of our groups actually now recently, groups in business and management. And I was in NMIMS, Narasimhanji Institute of Management Studies, which is one of the top management schools. And one of the current dean, Dr. Butt, is actually an old, you know, ex-colleague. I mean, we have co-authored a couple of papers. And he's like a mentor, like how Professor Butt is a mentor to a couple of you. And When I was in Bombay, he constituted a talk to his faculty, not to the students, to talk to faculty about evidence. And one of the things he said that the entire management is bogged down by what is called as best practices. A management consultant or a management thinker comes and spends 10 years on something and calls it as best, and he sees something working, and that best practice has become a norm in management circles. There is no evidence to say, can it work in something else? And he himself has not looked at any evidence. So he said, if you want to break out of it, only systematic review or evidence synthesis methods can actually use that. So the domain of evidence synthesis is not restricted only to social work. I'm exposing you to that, but there are other domains in business and management, public health, development, education, where these evidences become much more regularized, but also institutionalized. In India, we are still talking about as an academic exercise, whereas in the UK, there's a What Works Center, and if you go to their website, it will even have all the education interventions are grouped. This is the method to teach class 4 on this topic. Even for teaching maths, they have a method of effectiveness, and they do randomized controlled trial at almost 30% of the schools at any given time are exposed to a randomized controlled trial, and that is how they learn whether which are the best education practices to be used in their own school. There's a similar model in the Norway called the Nordic model, and the US you have another group which is working on that. So there is this different. So in these countries, it's actually already institutionalized. Government doesn't do programs there because they feel this is the best way to do. They actually use evidence to justify or plan their interventions. So I'll come back to just what is systematic review so that people understand that this is a method, one of the ways to interpret evidence or constitute evidence. Basically, systematic review is a systematic approach to summarizing the results from all existing studies on a specific question. So for example, this particular, what you see outside some of these blue pages are actually called as plain language summary. A plain language summary is basically a two-page summary of the entire document, which is like a systematic review document can go up to 100, 200 pages. Nobody's got the time to read that. So a two-page document is a summary of that. So feel free to pick it up from outside and know what is. So this particular program is, they are talking about how evidence-based healthcare can be trained to health professionals. Right? Now it's important, healthcare professionals should know what is evidence-based healthcare, but this is talking about which is the best way to teach them. So they have compared between pure online, pure face-to-face, and a blended learning. That means a little bit online, little bit of face-to-face, right? And they've reviewed some 8 studies, most of them including randomized controlled trial, and it has shown that a blended learning approach is more effective compared to face-to-face or pure online to teach evidence-based healthcare for healthcare professionals. This is how you plan a program. Now, you wanted to design a program for teaching evidence-based healthcare, but this tells you that blended learning, that is an online-offline approach, is more effective compared to a pure online or a pure offline approach. This is what is meant by, so if you're designing a program, you should be looking at a systematic review or existing, and you're not expected to conduct one. You're expected to synthesize one. Now, what is meta-analysis? Meta-analysis is basically a statistical, it comes like a forest plot, yeah. Now, the systematic reviews basically are synthesizing all the studies, right? Now, you could have one study which says online is more effective. And you'll say two studies, and you have three studies which say, oh, face-to-face is effective. And you have five studies which say, oh, blended is effective. So ultimately, how do you synthesize? You can't come to a conclusion because you have one saying, few studies saying yes, few studies saying this, and few studies sitting in the middle. So a statistical test to synthesize that evidence and come to a pooled is what is called as a meta-analysis. So you come with one effect size to summarize the effect of all the interventions into one single digit and say, does it work, yes or no? And if yes, what is the confidence on that particular outcome? So that is what is meta-analysis. And every published document becomes a primary study. When I say publishment, it's not just peer review, any published document. And impact evaluation are basically, you've already gone into it. So this is what is a systematic review and meta-analysis. There's no minimum or maximum number here. But for meta-analysis, you need at least two or more studies. The way that we do it is what is called as a systematic synthesis. We have to set what is, the first thing is we do what is called as a critical appraisal, right? And what we do is we subject the every study depending on the study design. So if it's a randomized controlled trial, we use its own checklist. If it's a qualitative, we use its own checklist. If it's a mixed method, we have its own checklist. Irrespective of whether that study has been published, yes or no. And there is an objective assessment using that checklist to assess whether that particular study is of high quality, moderate or low. So I'm repeating again, which I mentioned in the morning, publication status has no relation to the quality of a study. And you subject them using a risk of bias tool, which could be for quantitative or qualitative or mixed method or economic, to assess the quality of that published study. Is it understood? Now, some of you are not familiar, so I can't explain in detail. Only thing what I'm saying is there is a component within system, before systematic synthesis, sorry, as part of systematic screening, is you're also identifying you're doing a critical appraisal of all the final identified studies. Okay? So in the review process, you have PICO, which is basically setting the question. So you have PICO is basically stands for population, intervention, comparator, and outcome. Then you have to do a systematic search strategy. There has to be a systematic screening. That means you will only use inclusion, exclusion criteria, a systematic coding, systematic synthesis, and a systematic reporting. And then finally engage with policy and practice, right? But in the evidence-informed practice, you're only using existing reviews. So if you're designing a evidence-based healthcare program for healthcare professionals, then all you have to do is check for reviews and check whether that evidence says what works to teach evidence-based healthcare to healthcare professionals. You don't do a review. But I'm just telling you that in a systematic review, all these are steps to arrive at those 8 studies. So in all the PLSs, you'll find eligible studies by number or whatever. Okay. So I'm just taking an example so that we understand what it means by this. So this is something that I and a couple of us are involved, and they are mostly pediatricians. I come from a health economics evidence background. And kangaroo mother care right now is not universally implemented, right? Basically, it means that if you go to a private hospital, they will not teach you this because kangaroo mother care is more cost effective compared to a baby being put in incubator. The same thing is not done in a government hospital because the nurses and the doctors don't have time to explain KMC to mothers. So kangaroo mother care has been shown to be one of the cheapest and the most cost effective methods to manage perinatal deaths and mortality and morbidity. Sorry, not perinatal, prenatal. Right? So basically, the children who are born in that neonatal period are children born from the day 1 to 27 days. So in that neonatal period, the babies can be most cost effectively managed if you're using a methodology called as kangaroo mother care. Basically, it doesn't look like much difficult. See that lady, she's opened a blouse, she's putting the bare skin of her to the bare skin of the child. So the heat transfer from the mother to the child gets, and that thermoregulation can happen. Now, if you notice, she is sitting in a hospital ward. The other problem with kangaroo mother care is most of the interventions are done purely in hospital. Nobody does it in the community, right? So basically, it's a mother method of care practiced on babies, usually on preterm, and where the infant is held skin to skin with his mother, father, or substitute giver. Now, if you look at the title, we have done a systematic review to understand what is the cost effectiveness of kangaroo mother care. Kangaroo mother care, you notice in my previous example in the morning, that it's already been shown to be effective. You saw that 3 reviews, one is 2000, 2011, 2014. So I don't need to bother about effectiveness because that is already there. But because we needed to place it as a policy to the government as and also to doctors and other nurses, we said we wanted to understand, is it cost effective as well compared to, say, conventional clinical care? So we set out and did a review, and we looked at the analysis, and we used only the cost and the cost effectiveness studies. We did not look at effectiveness because that's already proven. So we identified 183 studies from these many databases. We removed 77 because one study can be in multiple databases, so those are called duplicate studies. You removed that. Then we screened 106 titles and abstract. We excluded them for these reasons. Then we finally included 19 papers, of which we excluded so and so. And finally, we included 9 papers, of which 3 were resource utilization, 2 were cost analysis, 3 were cost analysis, and 3 were cost effectiveness. So this is how we identified the evidence. And then we could show that cost analysis, kangaroo mother care was found to be 50 to 70% cheaper compared to conventional mother care across all the studies. Huge cost difference. And the length of stay of the babies which are exposed to kangaroo mother care was much lower compared to children who were put in conventional medical care. Conventional medical care would mean that babies are either in the incubator or in the NICU. So the number of days that the babies have to be, so even if they are in the NICU, if the babies are given intermittent kangaroo mother care, that means in between the mother came and gave that care, still it was found to be cost effective. And these are all the cost minimization that if you include it to the entire country, the savings are between, see, $233,000 to $166,000. This is in, Broughton did it in Colombia. This is in another, this is from India. So two studies, randomized control trial studies, compared kangaroo mother care versus conventional mother care, and they compared the cost. They found that the cost savings for one child was between $450 to $512. Can you imagine how much total cost can be reduced? And there's no cost. All you need is a nurse who's explained the value of kangaroo mother care, and that nurse spends some time during a routine care to work with these women, mothers, and explain them the value of kangaroo mother care. That's all. There is no other cost. So this is the evidence that we generated. We disseminated in the International Kangaroo Mother Care Conference in Italy in 2016. Then we also submitted as we were in my co-author, Dr. Nimbalkar, who is a neonatologist, was invited by Quint, which is an online news article, was invited to make comments, and he mentioned that this could be the significant cost reduction. And our review actually got the best poster award in a neonatology conference in Gujarat, pediatric conference. Now, did we stop at that? No. What we are now doing is we are taking the policy brief of that study and submitting it to Indian Council of Medical Research so that they can universalize this in the month, in the maternal child guidelines for the government of India. Because if you can just imagine the kind of savings that the Ministry of Health can manage if they universalize kangaroo mother care across all public health settings. This is how you inform evidence to policy. And then you work with them using an implementation to do the practice as well. And since we did not find any community-based studies, this was actually now ongoing where you are using a community-based intervention. So mothers who are getting discharged with their babies, they are now trained to continue KMC in their homes so that the benefit of the kangaroo mother care can be seen for a longer period. So we are actually doing a study and we are comparing the cost to show that the cost savings is beyond the hospital settings as well. So this is how you take the evidence to dissemination and dissemination towards an evidence, towards a policy and a practice.